good. The customer success manager in Synergetics, and he has 20 plus in this field and also 5 plus years of experience in Azure Cloud Services. Sir, I request you to go ahead with the question.
We can't hear you.
Am I audible now?
Yes, now it's audible.
Okay, thanks a lot. It's a very typical scene, you know, start a seminar when before preparing you were on mute and it was just on a mute. That's what, that there was an error there. So very quickly, you know, just let me define the agenda for the session today, right? I'll have to give you a certain background in terms of, you know, what is the environment in today's world about a data center and why cost management is an important scenario. Then when we are talking about cost management, what are the different focus areas, certain tips and tricks and solutions to do your cost management as well as optimization, and what's coming in this particular area of focus, you know, what's new that is happening. So these are the few, this is the agenda of the webinar today. So let's understand what is an enterprise today. First and foremost, everyone, you know, who wants, whether it is a startup or it is an enterprise, have started moving their workloads onto cloud. Reason being, cloud is very, you know, kind of friendly in terms of provisioning your resources. And that's where, you know, once you start provisioning, it is fast enough. People start putting in more and more resources. And suddenly, you know, for an enterprise, a bigger enterprise, where there are more than 1,000, 10,000 employees, you have already millions of resources already on the cloud. There are multiple SKUs there. But and every department, every small part of that organization is creating resources on cloud. Furthermore, to complicate, there are organizational strategies. We say that we cannot depend on one single cloud vendor and we'll have to have more hybrid clouds, and we'll have a multi-cloud strategy. So you have people out from different OEMs as a cloud vendor. And when this is happening, you know, it is across businesses, across departments, multiple units, multiple projects, and there is a huge list where, you know, resources are built left, right, center onto the environment. Now, this is very easy to tell, and that's where the cloud is meant for. But the other side of the cloud is whatever small resources fund or whatever small resource provision, you have to pay a cost for it. Right? So basically, when we think about cloud, right, there are certain, you know, this is a full stack cloud management. This is what you normally do as when you define, you know, or, you know, start your journey towards cloud. First and foremost, you see that, you know, can I configure my VMs properly? Can I configure the resource properly? Then the next part is, if I'm configuring it, can I monitor those? Yes, if you can monitor those, can I protect those? How secure are those? And finally, when all these pillars are in place, the final pillar which comes in is governing these resources. Now, when you are trying to govern the resources, you do policy management and control your resources or govern them. You should have right visibility into your resources. And when you have the resources, cost management becomes very critical as part of the entire management capabilities. So let's understand what is an enterprise and who all manages enterprise scenario in terms of a cloud, and what are the different roles involved as part of a cloud spend. Now, if you look into yourself as an IT executive, this is what he thinks, and we need to understand cloud spend across the organization to ensure the best ROI. So there are IT executives who are looking for the best ROIs. Then we have a finance team, which is looking that, you know, though you are spending, can I get a kind of budgetary information in terms of how much will you spend in the year? Okay, and then there is a project team that given a budget in terms of, you know, their project, how are they controlling the cost with respect to the budget allocated. So these are different roles, these are different responsibilities across different teams who are actually touching cloud from their perspective, and each of these roles and responsibilities has a pivot which is called as cost. So let's see, you know, in terms of cost management, what exactly is the focus area? First and foremost, when we have such resources getting provisioned on cloud, right? The first and foremost is you'll have to monitor your cloud spend. So it is, you know, it is always said that whatever you monitor gets done. So basically, you have to have visibility into what you are spending. So you have to monitor cloud spend. You have to see, track usage and the cost trends. Suppose there is a workload, you know, you want to understand how it is being used, because we have opted cloud so that the workload can be provided at elasticity, which means if today there are 10 servers, suddenly if the load increases, there should be 50. Fine. We have done all the arrangements. So how much of this are we spending and what is the usage? Does anyone tracking that usage? And if there is a usage, obviously there will be a cost. So you have to cost, you know, identify this trend. Then whenever we build an infrastructure for an application, there are certain scenarios. Many a times what happens is you are spending onto anomalies, and there are usage inefficiencies wherein you have created a cluster, for example, a SQL, or for that matter, a MySQL cluster, and it is hardly being utilized. In that case, how am I making, and if this is purely an inefficiency in terms of resources. So how can I, you know, move away from this inefficiency and build a proper cost efficiency? In terms of looking into a previous trend of and track usage, can I predict something in terms of a budget? So that's where, you know, can you forecast how much the workload can be, and based on that workload, what cost can be? And all this still today, is there, you know, we want to have it, we want to do it, and is there an automatic way, or is there this kind of data which can be visualized? So this is in terms of, you know, if you want to really monitor a cloud spend, this is what you should be doing. Now looking into from an organization perspective, you know, we'll have to drive organizational accountability. Now this is very, very important, right? So that you have right levers to fix when it comes to optimization. So we'll have to allocate usage and cost to business units and projects. So which means whenever there is a workload getting in, you should identify, ask them to prepare a budget. Once they prepare a budget, they define, you know, this is the cost, they have allocated certain funds there, and accordingly, you know, someone has to be accountable for the calls having overrun. So you'll have to allocate that, identify resources which are used purely by the project or the unit, and you should be rightly able to provide chargebacks. For example, if a resource, for example, let's say a virtual network, right? So can we create different virtual networks for different departments, and you have department specific workloads in each of these VNets, right? So I can say, okay, a resource group where we can create this, or number of resource group which can be tagged as a department, and say, okay, fine, we have tagged this, now the cost can be accumulated, and we can actually, you know, filter the cost as per those tags, and this then say that, okay, this is where the resource, this is what you have utilized as a department, this is the cost. Certain costs have to be taken at a portion level, wherein, you know, if you are using firewall across the organization, then number of departments can share the cost. So you have to provide a right chargeback model inside the organization so that the cost is properly managed across departments. Now let team, and also, you know, one who is accessing this workload will always, or using this workload will always demand, can I get insights into whatever being utilized? For example, you have an organization which is a bigger enterprise, and you know, there are thousands of servers. Now one of the department is asking, I need to have a space where I will require 25 odd virtual machines. So okay, fine, we give them the create a VNet, we give them the connection. Now he wants to understand what is the usage of these 25 machines. Can I optimize it? Because optimization now becomes a accountability of the business owner, or the, you know, the role accountability which is defined with that particular person. So he will always ask, if there is an accountability which I drive, or the responsibility which I share, can I get insights onto that responsibility or accountability? So that is another place where, you know, this kind of users where they require, say, will require and say, yeah, do I get automated alerts? If I create a budget, can there be an automatic email if I cross certain budgets? 50% of the budget, if I cross, what to, can I get an alert? 75% of the budget, if I cross, can I get an alert? You know, so this will help us drive organizational accountability. And finally, optimize cloud efficiency is more in terms of, you know, increasing resource utilization with the right sizing. If there are ideal resources, ask the business owners or the, you know, relevant project owners whether things are meant to be idle, or let's shut down and create a shutdown plan for such kind of ideal resources so that they can be optimally used. Now if there a workload which is unpredictable and which has to run 24/7 on cloud, I think by now everyone have understood that cloud is no longer cheaper, it's a myth. A workload that is running 24 24/7 on cloud is actually, you know, is very, very costly as compared to the same workload running on-premise. Now, when we are trying to run a workload 24/7, then it makes sense to, you know, reserve such kind of instances or a defined dedication towards such resources. So when we are talking about efficiency, optimization is the path to success. And remember, my friends, it is more a discipline and not a one-time effort. So it has to be continuously monitored, continuously tracked, continuously changed, and so that we are optimally running our resources. So as you are aware, cloud is a constantly changing place. New projects are happening, new applications are provisioned. There are multiple workloads are changing, things are happening. So, you know, it's a constantly changing place. In that case, resource optimization is one of the key skill set an organization or an enterprise needs. Right? If you are identifying a resource, is the resource from a correct family? Is the size proper? What kind of resources, what kind of services, what types of services, what types of resources? All this has to be, you know, we'll have to draw a matrix whenever there is a deployment plan provided for the workload. If we don't do this exercise, your optimization will be a little late, and by the time you would have understood, you would have burned 6 to 7 months of, you know, your cost on oversized resources. So, you know, if you track it daily, your cost, if your plans are, your budgets are properly defined, then you can achieve a cost optimization, and you can get to know when to buy more, when to reduce it, and take the right advantage of cloud. Also by, you know, defining your reserved instances or define a dedicated kind of usage. So that will give you your cost optimization and build efficiency into your spend. So certain tips and tricks in terms of cost optimization. First and foremost, let's take a VM. If you're talking about infrastructure as a service, now if you really see, there are three VMs, there are three types of VM, three sizes of VMs. And if you really see, it is the same workload. Now, a perspective of each of the different user, they will have a different perspective inside the VM size. So normally a developer will choose a VM which is more higher and say that I need a bigger VM with so many cores and RAM so that my workload performs properly. Then there, someone has to identify which of this VM size actually deliver more success to the business. And when this is true, there is a finance head which says, or a finance guy which said, you know, can I reduce the cost and run the workload on an optimal in an optimal scenario so that we may pay what we are actually using, we are not oversized, and when it matters, I will have budget to change the size when there is an increase in terms of the usage of the workload. Right? So a same workload can have a different perspective from different roles looking into a particular deployment plan. So these are certain scenarios where, you know, the solutions for optimizing your cost, one of them is obviously reserved instance. The second is Azure hybrid benefit. Then you have right sizing of instances. You can shut down and start up your resources. deallocate your VMs and allocate them on time. Now all the developer community, please understand, there is a SQL developer edition also available where there is no cost for, you know, your SQL licenses. Then there is a scenario where you can bring your own SQL licenses. Then now this is MS SQL, migrate to PaaS services. This is again which can give you advantage. Use Visual Studio subscription key. So all those old timers in terms of having MSDN subscription, they will have their own MSDN keys which can be used on the subscriptions. Then you can do your Azure cost management and finally the Azure Advisor. So these are the ways, these are the different solutions for optimizing costs. So let's speak about, now let me give you more insight in terms of reserved instances and hybrid benefits. Now on the right side of the screen, if you see, if I apply all the things in one go, I get 82% of cost savings. Now what, how can I achieve 82% of a cost saving? Suppose you have a VM and you use pay as you go. So if you do a pay as you go model, and you are not sure whether it has to run tomorrow, you can always use a pay as you go model. But once you know that, you know, my workload, I have to move towards, you know, a 24/7 kind of scenario over a year long or in a 3 years long, then you can reserve that instance for 3 years. The moment you do that, your reserve instance for, you know, reserving an instance for 3 years can give you a cost reduction right up to 72% on certain instances, not all, but certain instances. Right? To top this up, if you have certain licenses, your data center OS licenses or your SQL licenses, which you can use along with your software assurance, then I think, you know, the Ahab advantage will more reduce cost by 10%, and you can then do an 82% saving on your cost. Now this is how, if you do use reserve instances plus have hybrid benefits, you can save good amount of cost. Now I like to speak more here. Suppose you have a workload which is a SQL server workload with front ends, which is, you know, IIS with Microsoft OS licenses. So if you have that kind of workload, right, so my suggestion here will be, or recommendation here will be, if that workload is running for 3 years, first reserve that instance for 3 years. So typically try to get the same size of VMs if at all your workload permits, and you can actually use the same size and reserve it for 3 years. Rule number one. Rule number two is, if you know that this is the kind of instances required at least by 80% of the OS license or the SQL license, and keep it with you and say, okay, fine, I can reduce cost by doing an Ahab. When you do this, you can actually save anywhere between 72% to 82% in terms of your resource cost. Because if you have OS license and SQL license, you have SA, and you are off for reserve instance, what you get is a cost of a Linux machine, and that is at, you know, much much cheaper on Azure. Nextly, if, you know, when we are talking about certain workloads, you should know what type or what size of VM you will require. Now, if you really look into any of the Microsoft documentation where you have Azure calculator, you will see, if you just click on a VM and you, if you want to select a VM, you will see, you know, more than 50 VM sizes plus types. So you have a choice criteria of almost, what you say, around 50 plus virtual machine size and type. Now, if you say I want a 4-core machine, in fact, you have 6 of them or 7 types which can give you 4-core machine. Now, what exactly workload are you running? So can I identify right size and right type for the VM? Suppose your workload is more in terms of your, you know, analytics kind of scenario or ELK and all those stuff. Normally, you know, the machine type is E series. If you are using a stable workload, then people say that you should use an F series for a web server. But if at all you have a SQL server, which then they say use a D series or F series for SQL server. So there are different types one should identify, do a small 1-hour research, and you will be able to get the actual size and type for your workload. So once you have identified this, then also identify the uses and see whether you can actually reduce your compute cost. One of the ways of reducing compute cost is if the workload is meant for, you know, business users or office users, then your workload is running Mac in a 12-hour scenario, say for example 8 in the morning to 8 at night kind of scenarios. And if you really calculate out of the 744 hours for a 744 hours in a month, and if you shut down it only during office hours and working days, then what you get is around 256 hours of usage, or you know, 236 hours of usage. It is 22 into 12 hours. So that is the kind of usage you can opt for, and which is actually 1/3 the cost of your VM. Now, if you are diligent in such calculations, I think you are saving good amount of money in terms of compute. And what can help you here is write the right automation script to do a startup and a shutdown. Shutdown still is a scenario in terms of, you know, you just go and it is configurable. But for a startup, you'll have to write a script, custom script today on Azure. Now plan a workload for, you know, a right usage. If you are using VMs which are behind a load balancer, see to it that some of the VMs behind load balancer are deallocated during less usage. If you really have that kind of privilege, then I think, you know, the right way of using compute can then be using VM scale sets, because they automatically turn on and turn off the resources based on your usage. So this can be an approach, and you can use automation to allocate and deallocate your compute resource. Next comes the SQL Server, because these are the post the compute. SQL Server is another costly SKU available on Azure, and this varies as per the edition. So you have, if you have built a cluster on SQL Server, then you will require an enterprise edition. An enterprise edition machine or SQL Server, which is 8-core and 9-core, will be easily ₹1 lakh on per month with no SA onto it. Now if you are using a SQL Server on cloud for your developer thing, then my suggestion will be, please use an image which is a developer edition image, and then you need to pay for the SQL Server license or the SQL license part in a VM or a compute cost. But mind you, it has to be only development. If it is beyond that, for example, you are using it for production, then don't create a developer edition. It stands against non-compliance. The other part of a scenario where you have, you know, your workload is using more than 4 cores or, you know, 8 cores of SQL licenses, and you are trying to build that as part of a compute cost, then I think you will burn most of your money on the SQL Server licenses. Now there are two ways to achieve this. Either if your workload is 24/7, in that case you will be building all the clusters across the server for high availability, because 24/7 workloads are meant for, you know, mission critical workloads. And in that case, I'll suggest that move towards a dedicated instance where the SQL Server is being managed by the platform itself, and you can save most of the cost of not building the cluster yourself, which is I am speaking about always on cluster. If still you want to have an always on cluster, then I will ask you to buy SQL Server licenses, the enterprise edition, do a one time investment and save on the cost by bringing your own license of SQL Server onto Azure. Mind you, it requires SA to have such licenses ported to cloud. So this is how you can save money in terms of SQL Server. The next part of the solution for cost optimization is migrate. If at all you are using infrastructure as a service, then migrate to PaaS service. So if you have a web application, migrate it to web app. If you have Microsoft SQL Server, use MS SQL service. If you have MySQL, use. So these are the services available today as PaaS services. So this can help you run 24/7 scenarios, and being a managed, it will give you a higher availability, and you can save cost of not building a cluster to provide you cost optimization. Now, at places where you want to do things, you leverage PaaS services for overall cost optimization. Use DR as a service, use Azure backup, and you can save good amount of money using such services. Now, if you are using SKUs, and I have to spoke about few SKUs. Now, people want to understand. I am not that conversant with cloud. I'm using Azure for the first time, and how do I save cost? Now, Azure Advisor comes to your benefits here. You know, you just go and quickly click on Azure Advisor, and it will identify all the inefficiency you have as part of that subscription, and it will give you all the recommendation. So even if you actually build Azure, adhere to Azure Advisor and actually implement most of the recommendations, I think you will be in a good shape to save more cost, and you are running your workload in an optimized manner, right? So it evaluates your environment and provides recommendations on availability, security, performance and cost, resizing or shutting down unused VMs, identifying where to take advantage of elastic pools. If you have ER circuits, how much of these is utilized, how much of that is not utilized, and all those reports are being provided and recommendations are being given by Azure Advisor. Now, Visual Studio subscription keys. Now, as I spoke, most of the veterans as part of Microsoft technologies, they had a habit of buying Microsoft, part of MSDN subscription or a Microsoft developer subscriptions. Now, when you have this subscription, you have the ability to use keys on Azure virtual machine. So some of you who are MCTs can get these subscriptions, right? And you can use those keys as part of your SQL Server, Windows machines or your SQL Server machines. You can use those keys. You can get your bring your own license as well as part of those kind of MSDN subscription. But mind you, this can't be used for production system, but very well can be used for UATs and your developer scenario or our development environment. So very quickly look into what an Azure advisor gives you. If you remember the screens, it gives you the impact, and if you see there is an impact which says, you know, there is a right size or shutdown underutilized virtual machine, and you can save this cost as part of that savings if you actually right size or shut down the virtual machine. So you should implement advisor recommendation, a few other recommendations. So Azure advisor gives you actually a very right recommendations. Even if you recommend most of those, you will, you know, actually save good amount of cost on your Azure subscription or Azure spend. More tips and tricks in terms of saving your cost is design your workload for elasticity. If you built in proper elasticity, then you can actually automate proper shutdown of your front ends and the app servers, which can give you cost benefit. If you are using something called as notification queues or service bus, then I will suggest that go ahead and use Azure functions or Azure application services, which will give you cost benefit as you use the pay as you go models, and it will get charged only for what you use. So these are kind of per call, per notification basis, and you will tend to save good amount of money if you leverage and use this application services. Then, you know, as part of your deployment scenario, actually plan for a resource group strategy, because this helps a lot when you are deploying resource group. Actually provisioning resource. For example, if you are creating a workload and you create your resources as part of single resource group, it helps. Right? Because if your work is done, you just have to go ahead and just delete the resource group. So this is how resource group is useful. Mind you, if you are planning to do this as part of your production environment, then this is not a good idea. And remember, those who are using resource group, diligently go and actually put a lock on your resource group so that these other resource group and the queues inside the resource group are not deleted by an accident if you are using it on a production environment. But yes, resource group gives you billing segregation as well. So if your things are built according to the workloads into identified resource groups, then your billings and chargebacks can be very easy. Now, in the workload scenario, if you are using caching and compression, then you should use the right CDN for your content, because if the choice is improper, then you tend to spend more money on CDN. So this is a architectural piece. There has to be a proper matrix identified for the right, choosing the right CDN provider for your workload. Then another best practice which I'll suggest is do continuous optimization of your architecture just to save cost, because this will help building an optimal resource, and then you can earn big amount of money if you actually save good amount of cost on underutilized resources. So a small architectural change can help you a lot. For example, if you are using in proc sessions and suddenly now you make an out proc session, then divide your front ends into two small parts. One of the part can be shut down in the night, and you can get an order for cost benefits of at least half the resources not being utilized for almost 14 hours a day. which is a huge cost savings with the kind of compute cost you pay as part of your Azure spend or a cloud spend. And optimize the provisioning based on consumption trend. So you'll have to understand the consumption, you should understand and track the resource, and on the trend provided, keep optimizing your resources. So these are certain tips and tricks to look into when you are managing your workloads on Azure. So let's see, you know, what's new in cost management. If you want to really do cost management, how actually can we do cost management? So sir, there are certain scenarios in terms of cost management. First and foremost, it is cost analysis. How do you do cost analysis, cost allocation and chargebacks? So I spoke about more in at defining your workloads into right resource group, tagging them so that you can define your chargebacks according to the resource groups and tags. You can define your forecasting. If you actually can forecast, then you can create budgets. You can have alerts on your budgets, and finally, you know, minimize wasteful usage and maximize the discounts. So these are certain scenarios where you can manage your cost. So let's see one by one of those, which is Azure cost analysis. So if you really look into, there was a product by the name CloudIn for a year and a half back, which was then purchased, you know, the entire product was bought in by Microsoft, and now Microsoft is showing as part of cost analysis through the same Azure portal, portal.azure.com. So if you have looked into it, this is one of the dashboards it shows in terms of your giving you cost, accumulated cost across services, across location and account names. There is a further cost, a different kind of view, which is called as accumulated cost, and this will give you enough cost. And if you remember, it will also show you a forecast based on the cost incurred during the month. So it will define a forecast cost and an overage forecast in that month. So, you know, Azure as a platform will always help you to identify what exactly your costs are, and it will help you to forecast your cost as well. If you do this, then you can create right budgets, you can define right alerts on those budgets. I'll tell you how to do that, but this is more in terms of a cost analysis. And as I said earlier, what gets measured get done. So if you are measuring your cost, you'll always tend to save them. This is another piece where, you know, another view of your cost, and this is in terms of a daily cost, day wise how much are you getting billed. This is another view where you can actually view your accumulated cost based on group by. Now this is a group by in terms of your resource type. You can group by resource groups as well. So this will help you to do chargebacks. So, you know, you actually can understand grouping and filtering options. You will have to identify this and create your own dashboards. You can actually create your own dashboards where you can get this cost, and you can build your custom views, and you eventually can share these views. If you are an IT department person, you can share these views to your, you know, business owners, so that they can also keep monitoring the cost. And the best part today is, you know, you have different defined roles inside Azure a subscription. and you can provide RMAT solutions. So these are the different roles for different user set. So a owner can view cost and manage everything, including your cost configuration. Then you have a contributor role to manage your cost, but he can't do any changes as part of the access control. Then you have a reader, but he cannot make any changes. Then you have a cost management contributor, and he can view the recommendations. Then you have a management reader. Again, he can view cost data, cost configuration, and view recommendation, but he cannot do management of cost configuration. So these are the different cost management built-in roles inside Azure subscription, which one can use, and then add users or create group based on this, so that you can give proper reviews to your end users or the customers. I'll wait and wait for a 5 minutes break, and I'll continue another 5 minutes. Okay, let's begin. Okay, now let's see, you know, we have spoken about how do we define cost management, move towards cost management is how do we define budgets. So you actually can say that, you know, you can use Azure calculator and for the workload identify what are the SKUs, what will be the cost, and then define a budget and say, okay, for this resource group or this subscription name, for a budget for this kind of resources, and start defining your budget. And you can define a scope for a resource group, and you can build everything into that resource group and monitor your budget for that particular those resources inside those resource groups. And once you have actually defined your budgets, you can start evaluating the budget. So it will give you an indicator in terms of, you know, your current spend, how much are you progressing, and where are you in terms of your budget, and the period in, you know, from where, how much has been utilized because you have given that kind of budget, and how much of the budget has been, you know, utilize. So those kind of insights you can evaluate with your budgets. Now, mind you can see this screen with the defined RBACs which I have earlier defined, saying that, you know, you can use these rows which can help you define budgets and see evaluation of the same. Now, on based on the budgets, you can define your alerts and say when it crosses 90% of the budget, then you define a group and define an action type based on that group. For example, you know, you can create an action group and you can define, you know, what to do in terms of an action group. Do you want to send an email as well as SMS? Now you can configure all this into your budgets so that the users are rightly notified, saying that, you know, there is a cost overrun over budgets, and then for the kind of budget provided for the next 3 days, let's, you know, reduce the resource so that, you know, we have still more budgets to be utilized over a period of time. And this is a final alert kind of scenario which you can see, and you can actually create multiple search alerts for multiple groups. And if you really look into the last entry where you can, you know, have those as part of webhook, so you can create a subscription for the webhook and you can start seeing that into whatever format you want to or whatever information you want to share across your workload users. Now, the best part of Azure cost management is there is a different API which is called as Azure Consumption and Charge API, which can be used, which will give you balance summary, your usage details, the price sheet, and the marketplace data in an automated fashion. Right, and mind you, this format is a JSON format, so you can build a small screen to use this APIs. So there is an Azure Consumption and Insights Content Pack. So those who are using, for example, an erstwhile service called as OMS or now a log analytics kind of service, you can get the insights. Consumption and Insights Content Pack, you can subscribe to this and you can build custom visualization provided by your content pack, and you can start viewing your cost and usage. Now this is available already on Azure. Then you have a Consumption and Insight Connector, where you can build advanced cost and usage analysis using the Power BI desktop. I have created a sample for this One of our engineers has helped us build this, and I'll show you, you know, how does it look like. So this is a small kind of view which one can create as part of your Power BI. You see how beautifully the graphs are being displayed for the consumption. So very quickly, you know, understand what's ahead. You know, I have helped you understand the cost management and defining your budgets, setting alerts on the budgets, and now we'll look into what's ahead in terms of the cost management. First and foremost, these are certain upcoming releases. Most of these would have already released, like the hierarchy management. So it is giving you an management groups where you can manage your hierarchy. It gives you unified management experience. Now there is a merge of erstwhile EA portal and account portal. Though EA portal still exists, very soon it will be merged into one single portal. Then you will have better cost visualization and analytics. So even that is provided. So every 3 months, 2 months, the cost analysis, if you are regularly watching the cost analysis tab inside Azure subscription, it is having richer and richer. It is getting updated by richer and richer UI. Then there is API enhancement happening. You are getting a unified cost APIs. You are getting CSV files which you can download, and you can create graphs in your Excel. Then you have ARM based authorization available for this API management, and API support for all the new functionality. So if you really look into, these are certain API enhancements that are happening currently, and in terms of you saving more cost, then you have spot VMs and dedicated instances running on Azure. So this is in more in terms of how can you build hierarchy. Now if you really look into the left side, you have an enrollment, and you can create, now this happens as part of your EA portal, and you can build an organization, have multiple departments. Now that hierarchy you can build as part of your EA portal, and then you can have your management groups, right? And on the right side, you can define your management groups. So sales department is a part of management group. Engineering department is part of a management group. And then inside this management groups, you can have individual subscriptions and resource groups, and then the resource beneath the resource group. So this is how an hierarchy you can define. So, you know, you putting restriction in terms of access control or managing and governing the resources, hierarchy plays a vital role. Right? So please do use the management groups as part of your Azure subscription portal. Now simple, and see, now we will look into, you can get then a view of cost by resource or a cost by resource group, a subscription, and then by department. So you will get all this cost drilling down scenarios when you do proper hierarchy management in terms of Azure portal. Now most of these are like resource group and subscription, you can actually migrate your resources from one subscription to another or resource group. Most of these is a metadata change, unless and until, you know, they are onto different region, that's where the challenges rise. So, but you can still do some of these migrations across subscription and build a proper hierarchy, which can give you your cost optimization management scenario. So another management group kind built. Right, so on the EA portal, if you see, anything that can be managed is through, on the left hand side, through EA portal, and from once the subscription is defined, then everything on the right side can be managed onto your Azure portal. So management group is a new release in the past 6 months. So it will give you multiple subscriptions, nested subscription. It will help you build custom hierarchy, and it will help you integrate service and cost management. And if you see on the right hand side, see the kind of hierarchy which can give you your cost views according to your management groups. So I was saying it was private, now it is an GA already, globally available. So no more a private preview. And you can define your custom RBAC role to view on the management part, management groups. So certain things which one can look into as part of the content. So those who want to take a snapshot of the same can take. These are certain useful links and certain sessions which you can go through as part of a related content. Any questions, I am ready to, but probably if you can, if you can do it one by one, it will be helpful. If I'll take 5-10 questions before we can, hand it over to Ishwari. Type in your question, I'll pick up random questions and I'll try to answer those. Those who want to type in the questions can type in. So those who are typing in a questions, for example, can I get this presentation? It is Ishwari who will answer those questions. If there are any related question more in terms of how to manage cost, I may be, answering those. Okay, over to you, Ishwari. There are no questions I am receiving.
Okay, sir. We'll wait for 2 minutes.
Ishwari, 1 minute. There is one question. Let me answer. So I am waiting. Let's wait for another 5 minutes. If there are any questions, then we can share. Sorry about the earlier announcement. How to manage 10 TB usage cost. So usage cost, how do I, what does this mean in terms of, managing 10 TB usage cost? Let me see if I can justify that question. First and foremost is, if you're using 10 TB of storage account, I don't know what is your usage, but first and foremost, identify what type of usage you will require, LRS or GRS. Based on that, you can optimize your cost. If your data is being properly backed up and everything, then I don't think you will require a GRS unless and until it is a regulated scenario. And LRS, a 10 TB cost will be better. Then moreover, you'll have to define the access policy. If it is just to store data, then I'll ask you to use archive that data in the archival scenario. That will help you save good amount of cost. I hope I have answered that question, because your question was a little more open. Can I, does it apply? or Power BI. RBAC does not apply for Power BI dashboards. But what you can do is you can create a group level scenario into your Azure AD, put users into your Azure AD and program for an access for a BI level dashboard for your different roles, role based users. Okay, Ishwari, over to you. And thank you, everyone. Ishwari, if you can take it forward from here.
Yes, sir. So thank you for the session. Everyone, kindly mail us your name, designation, company, contact number, so that we can mail you your certificate of participation. Okay, send us your details on my email address. I have mentioned it in the meeting chat. Just have a look at it. Thank you.
Thank you.
Rupesh, we can't hear you. Maybe you are on mute.
Wait. Hello. Now I'm audible. Hello.
Yeah. You have a question, Rupesh?
No, ma'am.
Yes, you're audible.
No. I have not any question.
Okay.
Okay, I'm not seeing more questions. So those participants who want to have similar session done inside their organization, I'll be more than happy to come and deliver the same session in your organization. You can connect with Ishwari on this. Okay, thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.